So, Rufus got a message from Mr. Dale, and it's the same message that Mr. Dale wants to share with all of you, which is, we had to not do Vacation Bible School this week, but we're going to do something we don't think we've ever done before. We're going to have Vacation Bible School in November. So November 11th, 12th, and 13th, a Thursday, Friday, and Saturday, we're going to do Vacation Bible School. We're going to need your help coming up with a better name for it, because nobody's on vacation at that point. But, well, we're working on it, so we'll workshop it. But the idea here is that we're still going to get to do it. But Rufus, now, you need to make sure you don't make the same mistake Rufus made. Because Rufus thought he had to go to a place that was November to have Bible school. But we know it's not a place, right? Yeah. November is a month, right? So November 11th, 12th, and 13th, we're going to do a version of Vacation Bible School, and it's going to be amazing. So make sure you tell your parents. Make sure that you plan on being here and being a part of it, because it's going to be incredible, okay? All right, now here's what I want you to do. I want you to take your hands, put them up like this, okay? Can you do that? Okay, now I want you to start just shaking, just twist them a little bit. Okay, a little faster, a little faster, a little faster. Oh no, a little faster, oh no, a little faster. Faster you can go, and stick them together. Okay, keep them stuck. All right, now close your eyes and we're gonna pray, okay? I want you to listen. God, we thank you so, so much that even when obstacles come, you still give us opportunities to serve and love you. We pray for Vacation Bible School in November. We thank you for these kids. And God, we pray that you help us to find ways to serve and love you every single day. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, friends, Miss Karen is back there if you want to head with her to ETC. We come to our morning prayer time, and we have lots and lots of prayer requests that we need to share, and there was no way that I was going to remember them all, and so I wrote them down. So we obviously need, before I jump into prayer requests, as always, I want to make sure that you know that we have a prayer list that goes out every Wednesday. It is an opportunity for you to be praying with and for our church family. And if you are not receiving that or our email newsletter, we would love to send those to you every week. You can come see me if you are not receiving those. So we have lots and lots of people that we need to be praying for. Obviously, we want to continue to remember the youth as they were away on their trip. We are praying for them. Many of you all have been praying for Nicole Dolan and her husband, Jeff. Nicole's our admin. She used to be the assistant director at the preschool. She was getting ready to leave Kenya on their mission trip, and she and her husband tested positive for COVID. So they have spent the last week there and were preparing to leave yesterday to be home today, and some bureaucratic thing happened. So she is still in Kenya and is over it, as you can well imagine. So please be in prayer for Nicole and for Jeff. They are discouraged, but continuing to be hopeful that they keep getting closer and closer to be able to come home. We pray for lots and lots of people who are dealing with COVID, as so many people we all know are. Martha and Dot, who continue to deal with COVID. We pray for... I just lost her name. That's embarrassing. Okay. It'll come back. We're praying for lots and lots of people who are dealing with COVID. We're praying for Kim Blackwell. They found a lump in her breast, and they are still continuing to seek out the best course of treatment for her. In addition, we are praying for Nita Hastings' daughter, Valerie, who is pregnant, and they have found an issue, a brain issue with the baby. So we are praying. They don't know a lot more right now than that. So please be praying for that as well. Obviously, I'm missing at least one, if not multiple. So please know that we bring all of our needs and all of our concerns and all of our struggles to God. One of the gifts of prayer is that we can unburden fully our heart and our life down with God. God knows all the things. We don't have to put on a front. We don't have to be fake. We can be truly who we are. We can offer it all to God and let God use and work and deal with it. What a gift it is to be able to pray. As we enter into our time of prayer, I will begin and then I will offer you a few moments of silence. And in that silence, you can offer up to God whatever burden or struggle you are facing. You can give God a praise, something wonderful that is happening that only God could have done. Or you can simply sit and be in the presence of the one who loves you the most. Sometimes silently adoring God is the best way that we can worship. And then I will close this. If you would you join me as we pray? We grieve, God, a world that is broken. We grieve headlines in the news which show pain and heartache, burden, tragedy, and struggle all over the world. But God, we also grieve connections and those who are hurting much closer to home, much closer to our hearts. It can be overwhelming, God, to look at the pain of the world. So in those moments, God, one of the most powerful and cathartic things we can do is instead turn to you. May we focus our eyes on you. May we see the good and the joy that you bring. May we understand your power and might, just a glimpse of it, so that we can understand that you have overcome the burdens of the world. You are bigger than any giant we face. We thank you, God, that we can turn to you and cling to you and worship you, knowing that you are the one who can set our path straight, knowing you are the one who can guide us. You are the one who truly loves us. We bring all that we have, all that we are, the good and the bad, the joys and the brokenness, and we lay them at your feet. May we be reminded again of the good news of the gospel, that your love came for us even while we were unworthy of it, and that we don't have to earn our way. You provide the way. Forgive us of our sins. Help us to turn afresh to you today. And we give thanks, God, that you hear our prayers. Hear our prayers now, O God. You are our mighty fortress. You are a strong deliverer. You bring peace that passes all understanding. You guide us step by step. When we are lost, you provide the way home. When we are stranded, you rescue us. When we were broken, you bring healing. You are awesome and mighty and worthy. And we love you. Thank you for hearing our prayers. Thank you for bringing us here. Thank you for your Spirit, which continues to guide and shape and teach us. May we be more like you. We ask all of these things in the wonderful name of Christ Jesus our Lord. Amen.
stand and join us singing "My New Savior"?
So in high school, I was in marching band for all 4 years. I know. Try and act surprised. So I was in marching band for all 4 years, and it was a really great experience. It was a wonderful time. And my senior year, I was elected as one of the band officers. Now, this was a 180, 195 person band, okay? So that's a lot of high schoolers to be shoving onto a field. So there were two drum majors who waved their arms and kept the beat. There was a band captain who did all of the behind the scenes detail work. In terms of organizing things, making sure everything's where everybody planned, everybody's where they're supposed to be. There were a bunch of second lieutenants who actually did all of the grunt work. The band captain said something, the second lieutenants went and did everything. And then there was a first lieutenant. That was me. However old I was, 17-year-old, I discovered the beauty of middle management in that they were all doing all the work. Chaney, my band captain, she had to plan everything. The drum majors had to make sure they knew everything. And I was just there. Now, I was already smart enough not to ask for assignments. You don't do that because people will give you things when you ask for things. So I made myself look busy. And in our marching band, we started every practice in block formation, where we're all practicing marching, getting the rhythm of how you do it, so that you're not interrupting your airflow to be able to play your instrument. And so you march in a certain way, and you march in certain, and you have to just sort of figure out how all that works. And march is the block is always led by some band officer who is using who's using their drumsticks to keep the beat. Now, it's almost always led by one of the drum majors, because the drum majors are there. But if not, it's led by the band captain. So the second lieutenants, their job is to go around and make sure everybody's doing what they're supposed to do. I never figured out exactly what my job was supposed to be, so I decided that I should look busy and just walk around, and that's what I did. And it was great, except for one day when the guy working with percussion and our two band directors called both drum majors and the band captain into a meeting as practice starts. So everybody shows up for block, and I look around, and it's a bunch of second lieutenants and me, and the volunteer dad guy who helps with the percussion. And the volunteer dad guy goes, "Hey, you, let's start block. Come on, get it going." And I look around wondering who he's talking to. And to my horror, I realize he's talking to me. I don't even know where my sticks are, because I've never used them. So I go over, and sure enough, they are buried at the bottom of my trumpet case. And so I pull my sticks out. Okay, band 10 hut, and we do it. And then that part, so far so good. But then it's the actual marching part. Now, anytime that we sing here, and you know, the band does such a great job, and some of you are so gifted and so moved by the music that you start clapping. I will never be one of those people who claps and joins along with you. And it's not because I don't like it. It's not because I'm scared of charismatic worship. It's because I can't sing and clap at the same time. I just can't. There are lots of things that I can do. This is not one of them. And so you get one or the other, and I really would rather sing than clap. But I always feel guilty when clapping starts, because I feel like I need to turn around and go, "I really am into it, you all should clap. I'm not going to, but you all should." So there's now 175 people waiting on my rhythm to figure out how we're going to march down the field. And at first, I've got it, because I'm focusing. And then the problem starts. Because the problem starts when I go, "Maybe I'm really good at this. I thought this was bad all along. And maybe, and sure enough, it becomes sort of like you imagine a bad teen marching band movie would go, where they're trying to speed up with me, and I realize I've sped up, so I slow it back down. And this goes on, it must not have been more than 30 seconds. It felt like 12 days to me as I'm doing this and just calling out orders and just, I'm sorry making you do this. When the percussion guy finally goes, "What are you doing?" And he grabs a set of sticks and goes, and I thankfully give it to him. And I will never forget that time and that moment and that feeling of, okay, I've got this. I'm keeping a steady beat. Look at me. I'm keeping a steady beat. There we go. Okay. Now it's back out. Okay. Now it's... And the idea of on my own, with nobody else around, the kind of rhythm that's necessary doesn't work for me. And it doesn't work for me because I tend to speed things up. I don't just do, I mean, obviously I can clap and sing at the same time, but the problem is I speed up without paying attention to some sort of outside guidance. I want to rush things. It's just what my natural default is. I don't know if it's yours, but it is my natural default that when I'm left to my own devices and I'm told we can do things at a proper pace, I tend to speed things up. I graduated college in 3 years. Why did I graduate college in 3 years? Because I took so many AP classes in high school that I had enough credits that I just finished and there wasn't anything else to do. This sounds like the weirdest humble brag, but the idea, it's not though, because I missed out on so much. I missed out when in trying to rush, I missed out on all the things that weren't easily checked. You can check off that you've finished a class, but you can't check off that you've learned how to interact with people your own age. You can't check off that you've learned how to just stop and enjoy a moment without constantly doing something all the freaking time. You haven't learned all of those things that need to be learned, but in my rush to get through to what I thought was going to be the end result, the end game, the end thing, I missed so much. I needed a director. Because once the drum majors are on the field, I don't have any problem. I was even able to play and march at the same time. This is not an issue because I'm not focusing on my own. I am looking at somebody else who is guiding me and telling me what the beat is, what rhythm we're going on, and how we're doing it. Left to my own devices, I want to rush ahead. We're talking about this because we're talking about the life of David, the Old Testament figure who Scripture says is a man after God's own heart. And if we're going to understand who David is and why on earth it has anything to do with us today, we have to understand the character and nature of David. We talked 2 weeks ago about David being anointed. Literally, Samuel the prophet opened up this jar of expensive spices and perfumes and poured it all over him in front of all of his older brothers and his completely bewildered dad, saying, "You are going to be the next king of Israel." And that is amazing, miraculous, unbelievable, except we talked about 2 weeks ago. The problem is there's already a king of Israel who wasn't interested in moving on to a different job. So David had to sort of sit with this. Then we talked last week about David and Goliath. And we talked about this story about how if we're not paying attention and if we have been around this sort of story before, you can just sort of see it as, you know, like a flannel graph or a cartoony kind of, David throws a stone and the giant falls down, yay, we all win. But it is so much more than that, right? It is so much more because when Goliath comes out and mocks God and God's people, everybody on the Israelite side, including King Saul, is terrified. They are terrified of this guy. That makes sense. Scripture says he's 9 feet tall. and the tip of his javelin weighs 15 pounds. He has another guy coming out carrying all of his armor in front of, all his shield in front of him because it's so heavy. All of that kind of stuff that's happening, this is an intimidating dude. He understands that. He uses that to his advantage. The entire Israelite side is terrified. David, who's not even in the army, shows up bringing lunch to his brothers who are in the army. Here's Goliath mock God and God's people. David, standing over here, goes, "Who's that guy?" And they go, "That's Goliath." And David goes, "Why are you all letting him do that?" And their answer, which we talked about last week, was, "That's why. What's wrong with you?" But David saw things completely differently. David didn't see the giant as someone who couldn't be beaten. He didn't see the giant as someone who was overwhelming every other possible option. What he saw was someone standing in the way of his God, and his God was the one who overwhelms every other option. His God was the big one. His God was the one who would bring victory. David went and fought Goliath because the battle wasn't David's, it was God's. And David knew that God was bigger than anything Goliath could throw at him. And sure enough, David swings his sling, the stone hits Goliath in the head, Goliath falls down, and then we joked about the very last verse, David pulls Goliath's sword out and cuts his head off. And that's that. There is this huge victory, this incredible victory, because David was the only one who saw the battle as God's, not as his. He, in the battle that he had to fight, he saw it as God's, not his. David said, "I've gone up against big predators before. God delivered me from their hand every time. God will deliver me again." He saw the battle as God's, not his. So here's what's happened since then. David has raised up and has become the head of Saul's army. He is winning battle after battle after battle, and the people are so excited about it, they've come up with a song. Now, we don't know the lyric, we don't know the melody of it, but we know the lyrics. And the lyrics of the song that the Israelites sing is that Saul, King Saul, has killed his thousands, but David has killed his tens of thousands. You can imagine, I'm sure it was just slamming, right? And you can imagine just about everybody loved that song with one notable exception. There was one guy who it gave pause to, and he was not a huge fan of this song, and that was King Saul. So King Saul gets so angry that he tries to kill David. David flees. And so now Saul has set himself up as the enemy against David. David knows, remember, two Sundays ago, David knows that God has chosen him. David knows that God has said, "You are going to be the next king. I have rejected Saul." Saul has now tried to attack David. If you were David at this point, or if this were a movie, sort of a blockbuster kind of thing, then there would be a montage where you get your crew and you're building up all of your A-team style shenanigans that you're going to go after King Saul with, and you're going to get him. And then the last scene in the movie, what's going to happen? You're going to kill Saul. And why is that? Because he messed with you and you're God's chosen. But that's not what happens here. Because what happens here is time after time after time, David gets close to Saul. Saul tries to kill David. David escapes. Saul says, "You know what? Oops, that's on me. I'm not going to do that anymore." David comes back. Saul tries to kill David. David escapes. One time, David got close enough that he cut off the edge of his robe, of Saul's robe. He goes back to his camp, which is on a different mountaintop. He holds up the edge of his robe and says, "I could kill you if I wanted to, but I'm not going to do that." Saul keeps going, "You know what? You're right. I was wrong. Come on back." And then finally, we have our scripture for today. So if you will turn with me to the book of 1 Samuel, we're going to look at chapter 26. starting in verse 1. Now some men from Ziph came to Saul at Gibeah to tell him, David is hiding on the hill of Hakalah, which overlooks Jeshimon. So Saul took 3,000 of Israel's elite troops and went to hunt him down in the wilderness of Ziph. Saul camped along the road because the hill of Hakalah was near Jeshimon, where David was hiding. When David learned that Saul had come after him into the wilderness, he sent out spies to verify the report of Saul's arrival. David slipped over to Saul's camp one night to look around. Saul and Abner, son of Ner, the commander of the army, were sleeping inside a ring formed by the slumbering warriors. So all of his bodyguards are sleeping in a circle. Saul and Abner are sleeping inside the circle, right? Who will volunteer to go in there with me? David asked. Ahimelech the Hittite and Abishai, son of Zeruiah, Joab's brother. I'll go with you, Abishai replied. So David and Abishai went right into Saul's camp, found him asleep with his spear stuck in the ground beside his head. Abner and the soldiers were lying asleep on the ground. God has surely handed your enemy over to you this time. Saul is sleeping on the ground. David is right here. Multiple times he has tried to kill him. What's our saying that culture has? Fool me once, shame on you, right? If you keep making the same mistake over and over again, it's finally time to correct it now. And Abishai, one of David's strongest, most courageous leaders, goes, look, he's right here. That's a Devane translation. That's not a word for word. So, God has surely handed your enemy over to you this time. Abishai whispered to David, let me pin him to the ground with one thrust of the spear. I won't need to strike twice. Which is a great line, right? It's a shame it's wasted here because that's a great line. I'll kill him. I won't need to strike twice. No, David said. Exclamation point. No, David said. Don't kill him, for who can remain innocent after attacking the Lord's anointed one? Surely the Lord will strike Saul down someday, or he will die of old age or in battle. The Lord forbid that I should kill the one he has anointed. But take his spear and that jug of water beside his head, and then let's get out of here. All right, this is remarkable, right? Now there's two schools of thought of this, and they're not mutually exclusive. So there's the cynical human school of thought in this that we at least need to acknowledge, okay? It is not good practice for the future king to kill the previous king, because then bad things could happen to the future king by the person who wants to be the future king. You follow me on that? So there is a pragmatic piece of this, but this is not written so that you, Art of War style, get tips for how you can make sure that you stay king or queen long enough. That's not what the Bible is doing. The Bible is showing you something different here. There is all the human reason in the world to get rid of Saul, right? You're David. You've already been told you're going to be the king. This guy keeps trying to kill you. If I get rid of him, I get to be the king. If I get rid of him, I don't have to be suffering like this anymore, right? There's no more caves that I've got to sleep in. I don't have to run for my life. Instead of going at God's pace, we can start speeding it up, right? And you would never say it like this, probably, but you're like, look, I can give God a boost. Here's a way where we can skip some of these steps, and I can just give God a boost to where we're going to wind up anyway, right? Like, why do we have to go around this route to get there? We can just take a straight shot, literally, straight shot, right through Saul, and we can get there. David says, no. David says, either
somebody will kill him in battle, or he'll die of old age. David is willing to wait for Saul to die. And David says, it's not going to be me who puts a hand on the king, on the Lord's anointed. Even though God had rejected Saul, David understood the anointing that he had experienced and Saul had experienced as so powerful that you weren't killing Saul, you were going against God's wishes. Remember, David and Goliath. For David, the battle was the Lord's. His view and theology, understanding of God, was so great and mighty that Goliath offered no possible way to be able to overcome it. This is the same view frame, this is the same viewpoint, the same framework, just worked out in a different setting. It's not that I've got to get rid of Saul. I trust God so completely and so implicitly that I can trust that God's timing on all of this will be exactly what needs to happen. I don't have to rush God's pace. I can move at what God's called. Marching band terms, I can follow the director. The pace, that the tempo the director sets for the direction of your life, you can follow it. I would imagine you all have experienced times where you tried to take a shortcut and speed up the tempo. Have any of those ever done anything but cause disaster and problems, right? I hear the laughing under your breath from the answer of, oh, yeah. David refuses to speed up the tempo. David says, it's not my place to kill the Lord's anointed. He will die how God wants him to die. And when that happens, then I will be king. This isn't something of, I still have a cushy office and I still have a nice job, but eventually it'll be nice to be the head of the whatever. He's running for his life. He's living in caves. He is desperately trying to stay alive, and he still refuses to push the tempo. He still refuses to rush God's direction and God's timing. Let's keep going. 12. So David took the spear and jug of water that were near Saul's head. He and Abishai got away without anyone seeing them or even waking up because the Lord had put Saul's men into a deep sleep. David climbed the hill opposite the camp until he was at a safe distance. Then he shouted down to the soldiers, to Abner, son of Ner, "Wake up, Abner!" "Who is it?" Abner demanded. "Well, Abner, you're a great man, aren't you?" David taunted. "Where in all Israel is anyone as mighty? So why haven't you guarded your master, the king, when someone came to kill him? This isn't good at all. I swear by the Lord that you and your men deserve to die because you failed to protect your master, the Lord's anointed." He is lecturing Saul's guys because they aren't taking their job seriously enough. This is David's viewpoint of those who God has called and anointed and chosen. They are set apart to be different, and they are set apart to have a viewpoint of God that is different from how the rest of the world looks. This, look around. Where are the king's spear and the jug of water that were beside his head? Saul recognized David's voice and called out, "Is that you, my son David?" And David replied, "Yes, my lord the king. Why are you chasing me? What have I done? What is my crime? But now let my lord the king listen to his servant. If the Lord has stirred you up against me, then let him accept my offering. But if this is simply a human scheme, then may those involved be cursed by the Lord, for they have driven me from my home so I can no longer live among the Lord's people. And they've said, 'Go worship pagan gods.' Must I die on foreign soil, far from the presence of the Lord? Why has the king of Israel come out to search for a single flea?" Even in lecturing to Saul, David is saying, "You are the Lord's anointed. You are God's chosen one. Why are you doing this? This is unworthy of the calling you have been given." Saul is scared. Saul is scared of human power instead of having a fear of the Lord that would be a healthy way that would lead to wisdom. I refuse. Here's your, let's do 21. Then Saul confessed, I have sinned. Come back home, my son, and I will no longer try to harm you, for you valued my life today. I've been a fool and very, very wrong. Here's your spear, O king, David replied. Let one of your young men come over and get it. The Lord gives his own reward for doing good and for being loyal, and I refuse to kill even when the Lord placed you in my power, for you are the Lord's anointed one. Now may the Lord value my life even as I have valued yours today. May you rescue me from all my troubles. And Saul said to David, blessings on you, my son David. You will do many heroic deeds and you will surely succeed. Then David went away and Saul returned home. Now, the best part, don't close it yet. Oh, everything's fixed and it's all better. The next verse, the verse one of the next chapter. But David kept thinking to himself, someday Saul is going to get me. The best thing I can do is escape to the Philistines. Then Saul will stop hunting for me in Israelite territory and I will finally be safe. David understands. This is not some sort of, God's going to protect me, so I don't need to do anything. I'll just stand here and everything will be fine. David is embodying the Jesus teaching of to be as shrewd as serpents, but as innocent as doves. You remember that? Jesus said, we are called to be as shrewd as serpents, understand the world, understand how we are supposed to live, but as innocent as doves. You don't act like the world acts, even as you understand how the world is. David's understanding and complete and total trust in the direction that God has, in the tempo that God sets, completely overcame any temptation he might have had to take a shortcut, to speed up, to do things that in his view would have led to the result that much quicker. Come on, God. This is easy. Why aren't we just doing it this way? This will make it so much easier. Our job is not to find the most efficient way forward on the path we think God's called us to. Our job is to follow the director, which means that we have to constantly be paying attention to the director. We have to constantly be paying attention to the tempo. We have to constantly be ready to move at the pace God has for us. There is a pace that the world wants to set for you, is there not? You may not even understand it or acknowledge it like this, but there is a constant pace. You get it. How many places in your world are you not tried to have something sold to you, for example, right? I still can't get over the commercials at gas pumps. Every single time it drives me crazy. Like, you can't even pump gas without somebody trying to sell you something. I'm already paying all this money for gas. The last thing that I'm thinking is, how can I spend more money right now, right? But there is this constant pressure and constant push to do what's new, to see the latest, to get the latest whatever, to see what people are being dumb about on the internet, whatever it is. There is this constant push to go faster and faster, more and more. It takes intentional work if we are going to choose to follow God's tempo, follow God's rhythm, follow God's direction. That's what we see in the life of David. All of these times that he could have taken a shortcut, he could have sped up the tempo, he refused to do it because he trusted the director, and he knew his one and only job was to follow the director's guidance. May that be the same for us. Would you pray with me? God, we confess how often we speed things up. We confess how often we try and jump ahead when it is not ours to do. We confess, God, that without you directing and guiding us, we will end up in a mess. What a gift you are. We say thank you again for your love and your mercy, your forgiveness and your grace. God, help us to find ways that we can stay focused on you. Show us the things we should say yes to and the things we should say no to so that we can follow your tempo and follow you more fully. We love you, we praise you, and we thank you. In Christ's name, amen. This is your chance to respond. as God has been moving and working in you today, this week, whenever, during this service, this is your chance to respond. You can obviously respond right where you are. Whatever you need to do with God, however you need to pray, whatever needs to happen, you can do that. But if you need something else, if you want to come down front and pray either by yourself or with me, you are invited to do that. If you want to make an official decision of whether you're joining the church or officially choosing to follow God and accept Christ, you can come talk to me down front about that as well. But God is working and moving in each of our hearts and lives. The question is, will we be open to listen, and will we be willing to follow the director? Would you stand as we sing?
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. My chains are gone, I've been saved.
Thank you so much for joining us in worship today. We have Bible study at 11:15 that we would love to have you come and be a part of. If you don't know where to go for Bible study, you can come see me and we will connect you to that. Don't forget, at noon today, we are having our choir informational meeting. Pat, our interim choir director, will be leading that. And so it's going to be here in the sanctuary. If you have any questions about that beforehand, you can come talk to Pat or simply be here at noon to let her illuminate you with the vision of what choir will be moving forward. As you heard Rufus and Dale talk about, November the 11th, 12th, and 13th will be our vacation Bible school. Maybe that's what we'll do. Just put a question mark with vacation. Our vacation Bible school. If you mark your calendars, we will have many more details coming up in the months ahead, but mark your calendars to be a part of that weekend with us if you can. All right. I'm missing an announcement. Maybe. Nope. I remember that. You told me to remember the choir one. Anybody else have one? Dale? No? Okay. No more softball. Sadly, I know, we're all heartbroken. Okay, if you would you bow for the benediction? May you go in the grace and peace of our Lord Jesus Christ. May you trust the director who sets the tempo for your life. May you trust his goodness, his love, his mercy. May you trust that he will safely see you home. Go in peace, my friends.
We'll see you
next week.